Hello and welcome to my class. In this video, I'm going to talk about structure, functions, and modifications of insect mouthparts. You might have noticed that different insects have very specific food habits. Some insects like to feed on solid food, some like a liquid diet. The food can come either from an animal source or it can come from a plant source. Now, depending on what kind of food they require and what kind of food are available in their environment, different insects specialize in feeding on different kinds of food. Now, to acquire this special food, they also have special types of mouthparts. Over millions of years, insects have evolved special mouthparts to feed on special or specific types of food. Now, depending on how these mouthparts work and what kind of food they eat, there are different types of mouthparts. And I'm going to talk about five types of mouthparts today. The first part is the biting and chewing mouthpart, which are found in grasshoppers, cockroaches, mantids, silverfish, etc. Then I will talk about the chewing and lapping mouthparts of worker bees. And then I will talk about the piercing and sucking mouthparts, which are found in dipteran insects, and they are known as dipterous type, and also in hemipteran insects, and this kind of piercing and sucking mouthparts are known as hemipterous type. Then I'll talk about the sponging or lapping type of mouthparts, which are used by dipteran insects like blowflies, houseflies, fruit flies, etc., to draw liquid from a flat surface. Then I will talk about the siphoning mouthparts, which works like a straw and it is found in adult moths and butterflies. Please remember that although I am going to talk about only five types of mouthparts, there are many other types of mouthparts which specialize other insects to feed on special types of food. But here, I am going to talk only about these five types. So, let's start with the simplest type, the biting and chewing mouthparts, which are found in grasshoppers. Now, if I take out these appendages, mouthparts are basically appendages of the head. And if I take them out from the head, then I will find a labrum, two mandibles, two maxillae, and a labia. They are arranged in this order. First comes the labrum, then the mandible, then the maxilla, then the labia. The maxillae and the mandibles and the maxillae are paired structures and they are present one in each side. The labium and labrum, these are single structures and they are present in singular numbers. Let's talk about the labrum first. The labrum is also known as the upper lip because it forms the anterior wall or roof of the preoral cavity. So all these mouthparts together, they form a preoral cavity which precedes the mouth. And labrum, which is a broad, almost rectangular vertical plate, forms the anterior roof of that preoral cavity. The labrum is articulated with the lower margin of the clypeus by a labroclypeal suture. The labrum in its posterior side or the side that faces the mouth, it has a chitinous swollen area. This part is known as the epipharynx. The epipharynx carries the taste receptors. So these taste receptors help the labrum in tasting the food before the insect bites into it. Here in this grasshopper, you can see the labrum very clearly. Now, let's talk about the mandibles, which are the paired, heavily sclerotized, triangular structures lying just behind the labrum on the sides of the preoral cavity. So, in each side of the preoral cavity, there will be one mandible. And each of these mandibles are triangular, heavily sclerotized, or with very thick chitin. These are the structures present with an anterior border with teeth. These teeth allow them to bite as well as chew. Mandibles work horizontally and they can cut and chew the food that comes in front of their mouth. These mandibles are the most crucial parts of the biting and chewing mouth parts, and they are moved by adductor muscles and the abductor muscles. In a grasshopper, you won't be able to see the mandibles very clearly because the mandibles are hidden behind the labrum. But in a wasp, where the labrum is a vestigial part, you can see the mandibles very clearly. Now let's talk about the first maxillae. The pair of maxillae that lie behind the mandibles are known as the first maxillae, and they form the sides of the preoral cavity. Here in this grasshopper, you can see the first maxillae very clearly. Now, a maxilla will have different parts, and here you can see that maxilla can be divided into three clear parts: the protopodite, the endopodite, and the exopodite. The protopodite is further divided into two parts, the cardo and the stipes. The endopodite has a jaw-like structure known as lacinia and a hood-like lobe known as galea. The exopodite is made with this maxillary pulp, which is connected with the protopodite by a structure known as palpifer. Now, let's talk about the labium or the second maxillae. They are known as second maxillae because the labium actually looks like a structure which is made by fusion of two maxillae. So that's why the labium is also known as the second maxillae. It is known as the lower lip because it forms the hind wall or the floor of the preoral cavity. Here in this grasshopper, you can again see the labium. This part is the labium, and here you can see the labial palp. Let's look at the structure of the labia. Similar to maxillae, this second maxillae is also divided into parts. This part is known as the postmentum, and this part is known as the prementum. So the basal or the proximal part is known as postmentum, and the apical part is known as the prementum. The postmentum can be divided into submentum and the mentum. So this part would be submentum and this part is mentum. Here is our prementum. The prementum bears the labial palp and four lobes in the interior side. These four lobes are known as glossa and paraglossa. The glossa are the internal one, paraglossa are the hood-like structures here. So, similar to lacinia and galea, here we have glossa and paraglossa. All these parts together, the glossa and paraglossa, the ligula is formed. Now, the function of the maxillae and the lower lip is to hold the food, and the mandibles bite as well as chew the food. This is how the biting and chewing mouth parts work. This is the most simplest type of mouth parts, and all the different mouth parts that I am going to talk from this moment onwards, they are actually modifications of these parts. In some mouth parts, certain parts are vestigial or reduced, and some parts are elongated or broadened. So let's figure out each mouth part one by one. Now I am going to talk about the chewing and lapping mouth parts which are found in bees. Let's first see how these chewing and lapping mouth parts work. You can see the mouth parts which are getting inserted inside the flower to draw the nectar from the bottom of the flowers. So the honeybees lap up the nectar from a flower. But honeybees and other bees make nests for their offspring. And these nests have hexagonal cells made of wax. Now these cells are made with the help of the mandibles. So they have labrum and mandibles which are chewing type, and the maxillae and labium are modified for collecting nectar. The mandibles, very specific to the bees, they are smooth and spatulate. They help in molding the wax to build the cells of the hive. And the labium and maxillae, they form the lapping mouthparts. So let's look at the modifications of the maxillae and the labia. The maxillae are supposed to have the lacinia and galia in their endopodite. But here the lacinae are absent and they have vestigial palps. So the maxillary palps can be seen here as these minute structures. What is elongated in the maxilla is this long blade-like galliae. So only the galliae or the hood-like structure of the endopodite is elongated here. The lacinae are lacking and the maxillary pulp are vestigial and present in this minute forms. Now let's talk about the labium. The labium has elongated palps. Here you can see the labial palps, unlike the maxillary palps, are elongated here. And they have reduced paraglossi, but the glossi are elongated and carved. If I take a section from here, you can see that this is the glossi, which gets elongated and gets carved. This forms the honey spoon. Okay, so these glossi are united to form a retractile tongue having a honey spoon at the end of it. This honey spoon like structure, which moves backward and forward to lap up the nectar from a flower, is known as the flabellum or the honey spoon. So the glossi forms this tongue, and at the end of the glossi, you would find the flabellum. If you see in this section, this part is the glossi, and the glossi are surrounded by the galia, which are these, and the labial palps, which are these. So this tongue-like glossi is surrounded by the labial palps and the galliae of two sides, and they form the lapping mouthparts. So honeybees use their mouthparts not only to collect nectar but also to form the hexagonal cells in their hives. So for that, they have spatulate smooth mandibles and they have this lapping type of modifications in their labium and in their maxillae. Now let's move on to the next type, which is known as the piercing and sucking mouthparts. Piercing and sucking mouthparts are found in hemipterans, which pierce through the plant parts and suck the plant sap, and it is also found in dipterans. But first, let's talk about the hemipteran type. Piercing and sucking mouthparts are found in most hemipteran bugs, and one example would be the red cotton bug. Let's look at the modifications of the red cotton bugs or any hemipteran mouthpart. Here, the mandibles and the maxillae form four needle-like piercing stylets. The labium forms elongated, segmented, dorsally grooved proboscis and encloses these four stylets. So here you can see that the maxillae and the mandibles, they from each side get elongated and form needle-like stylets, which are used to pierce through the plant tissue and suck the liquid. And the labium forms a covering for these four stylets. The two maxilla at the center, they join together and they form a hinge, and they form a salivary channel and a food channel. The salivary channel is used to pass saliva to the place from where the plant sap is sucked. And the food channel is used to draw liquid from that part. Now, when two maxillae come together, they form these two channels, the food channel and the salivary channel. These two maxillae, they are surrounded by the mandibles. Now, if they are drawing the liquid, what is the function of the mandibles? The mandibles actually help in piercing through the skin of the plant. and the labium's function is to surround the lot and keep them protected. Now let's talk about the mouth parts of mosquito. In hemipterans, the piercing and sucking mouth parts are used to draw up liquid from a plant source. And in dipterans, the piercing and sucking mouth parts are used to draw blood from animals. Here, unlike the hemipterans who had four stylets, there are six stylets. What are these six stylets? The two maxillae, the two mandibles, the labrum, and the hypopharynx. You can see here that we have the two maxillae in each side, two mandibles, and the two maxillary pulp here, which are elongated. And there is also the hypopharynx and the labrum, which are also stylet-like. Okay, so the maxillary pulp, you can see in this picture, they are elongated as well, but the maxillary pulp, they do not form the stylets. Stylets are formed by the labrum, the labium, the two mandibles, and the two maxillae. Now, let's see which part is doing what. The labrum, mandibles, maxillae, and hypopharynx form six long pointed stylets for piercing the host skin. The labrum is grooved ventrally. You can see the groove of the labrum here. And the labrum encloses all these six stylets. And when these stylets are inserted into the animal tissue, the labrum gets bent and it is left behind. It is too thick to insert inside the animal tissue. Now, if you look what is happening here, the labrum and the hypopharynx, they join to form a food channel for drawing the blood. The sharp ends of the mandibles help in piercing through the skin of the host. The maxillae help in keeping the tissue apart, and the sensory cells of labrum help to find the blood vessels. And finally, with the help of this food channel formed by the labrum and the hypopharynx, the blood is sucked up. So, when these six stylets are inserted through the skin, first role is played by the mandibles. The mandibles cut through the skin, gets all the six stylets inserted inside the tissue. The maxillae keep the tissue separated or keeps the tissue apart so that the food channel can work properly. The labrum helps in finding the blood vessel inside the tissue. Remember, the labrum has the epipharynx, which has the sensory tissues. So the sensory cells of the epipharynx helps in finding the blood vessels. Then with the help of the blood channel or the food channel, the blood is sucked up. You can see the blood is getting sucked up here, and the labium, which normally encloses all these six stylets, are left behind when these six stylets are inserted into the animal tissue. So this kind of piercing and sucking mouth parts help the mosquitoes in getting blood from an animal tissue. Remember, there are two types of piercing and sucking mouth parts. One is found in hemipterans who specialize on feeding plant sap, and the other type is found in dipteran insects like mosquitoes, which specialize in drawing blood from animals. Next type that we are going to talk about is known as the sponging or lapping type of mouth parts, and it is found in other dipterans like flies. And this kind of mouth parts are used for absorbing fluid food from a flat surface. Let's look at the special parts of this type of mouth part. Here, the mandibles are absent because there is no chewing required here. So, mandibles are absent. The maxillae are reduced and are represented by a single jointed maxillary pulps. So, maxillae you can only see in this single jointed maxillary pulp, but the other parts of the maxillae are absent. And they also have a proboscis, which is a fleshy and folding structure. When they use this mouth part, or when they use the proboscis, it is extended forward. Otherwise, it is bent in backwards and kept folded. This proboscis has three parts: the rostrum, which is actually a modification of Clypeus, and it also bears the maxillary pulp. Here is the rostrum. The next part, the hostalum and the sucker, these two are modifications of the labium. In the anterior side of the hostalum, there is a groove that bears the slender labrum epipharynx. Here you can see, if I take a section from here, you can see this part, that this is made by the labrum epipharynx, and at the bottom is the hypopharynx. The labrum epipharynx, is in the posterior side of the labrum. So the labrum and the hypopharynx together, they form the food channel. And the hypopharynx encloses the salivary duct as well. So in the hypopharynx, you can also see the salivary duct. So there are two channels here. One is for saliva to pass to the food so that it can be partially digested, at least outside. So this is preoral digestion. And this is the food channel, which is made by the labrum and the hypopharynx. And this food channel helps in sucking out the liquid. Now, this sucking out is not like the piercing and sucking mouth part. This is a little different. And that's where these suckers come in. The suckers comprise two oval lobes. So in the sucker, there are two lobes. These lobes are known as the labella. They have numerous transverse grooves, which are also known as pseudotracheae, in the lower surface. Pseudotracheae converge into the mouth. Here is a mouth that leads into the food channel. The pseudotracheae soak the fluid food and channel it from here, and it is sucked in by the muscular pharynx. So we have the sucker, which has the pseudotracheae or the transverse grooves. And because of surface tension, this part is put on the food repeatedly, due to the surface tension, the food is drawn to the mouth. And here is the food channel, which is made by the labrum and the hypopharynx. And the whole thing is enclosed by the labium. So once the liquid reaches here, the muscular pharynx pumps the liquid in. So this is the sponging and lapping mouth parts of flies. And these mouth parts are used to collect liquid from a flat surface. Remember that these insects would not be able to feed on solid food, right? They cannot take in solid food. How they eat solid food is they supply the saliva through this salivary canal, and they supply the saliva outside their mouth. The food is digested outside their mouth, and then it is lapped up by using this proboscis. So the proboscis is made of the labrum and the hypopharynx, and it is enclosed by the labium. So this whole proboscis is a modification of the labium, and in the groove of the labium, we have the labrum and the hypopharynx. So that brings us to the end of the types of mouth parts, and we will end with the siphoning types of mouth parts. Siphoning types of mouth parts are found in butterflies and adult moths, which help these mouth parts as a straw to draw liquid from the flowers. So flowers have nectars at the bottom, and these mouth parts are used to collect the liquid from there. See how these siphoning mouth parts are inserted inside the flower, and the nectar is getting drawn inside their mouth through these straws. Here, the labrum is reduced to a narrow transverse band. Here you can see the narrow transverse band, which is the labrum. The epipharynx is also reduced. The mandibles are also reduced. So labrum and mandibles, they are both reduced. So what makes this proboscis? It is made with the maxilla. And not the whole maxilla, only the galea of two sides of two maxillae. In the maxilla, the palps and lacinae are vestigial. But the galeae are long and deeply grooved medially. So here you can see that the galea of two sides, they get extended like a straw and they connect. And when they connect, because of the presence of this median groove, they form the straw. And this thing can be coiled up when it is not being used. And when there is a flower, it can be extended forward. And this straw can be used to collect the liquid from flowers. Now, these two galleae enclose this food channel and form a prominent proboscis. The labium is reduced but bears elongated labial bulbs. The hypopharynx and salivary channels are also absent here. So the nectar is taken in as it is. It does not require to be digested with the help of the salivary gland, and it is liquid, so it does not need any lubrication to get inside. So the two galleae from two sides, they are extended and they join together to form this straw-like structure, which can be coiled when not in use and which can be extended forward when in use, and can be used to draw nectar from flowers. So here you can also see another picture where the structure of the galleae is emphasized. You can see that there are trachea for supplying oxygen to the galleae, and there are these cuticular structures as well, which make the galleae. Now let's recap the whole story. We have seen six different types of mouthparts. The biting and chewing mouthparts, which is found in grasshoppers. This is the simplest type of mouthparts, and each mouthpart can be seen clearly here. Next type we have talked about is the chewing and lapping mouthparts of honeybees, which are formed by the labrum and mandibles that form the chewing type, and the maxillae and labium form the lapping type. And they form the tongue. The galleae will form the tongue and they will help in drawing the liquid. Okay. So the galleae of these two sides and the labial pulps enclose the glossi. The glossi form the salivary gland, and together they make a tongue-like structure, at the end of which there will be a honey spoon or flabellum. With the help of the movement of the flabellum, they will draw the liquid into the food channel, and the food channel will draw the nectar inside the mouth. So honeybees have their mandibles and labrum chewing type, which are used for molding wax to make the nest, and their maxillae and labia are modified for collecting nectar. Piercing and sucking mouthparts are first found in Hemipteran insects, which is formed by the two maxillae from two sides. They form a salivary channel and a food channel. Salivary channel passes the saliva and into the food, and the food channel draws the partially digested liquid inside the mouth. The two mandibles which surrounds the two maxillae help in cutting through the skin of the blunt tissue, and the labia keep them all together. In the dipteran mouthparts, it is again piercing and sucking, but it is different from the hemipteran mouthparts, because instead of four stylets like in here, there are six stylets here. The two maxillae, the two mandibles, the labrum and the hypopharynx, these form the six sharp stylets which are enclosed by the labium. These six sharp stylets are inserted into the animal tissue and the labium is left behind. The two mandibles cut through the skin, the maxillae kept them apart, the hypopharynx pass on the saliva, and the hypopharynx and labrum together, the labrum also helps in finding the blood vessels, And the labrum and hypopharynx together, they form this food channel, which is used to draw the liquid from the blood vessels. Next type we have talked about is the sponging or the lapping mouthparts of flies. And here you can see that there is a proboscis, which has three parts, the rostrum, the basal rostrum, then the hostellum and the distal sucker. The labium encloses a food channel made with the labium and the labrum and the hypopharynx. The hypopharynx supplies the saliva, and the food channel made with the help of the labrum and the hypopharynx draws the liquid from a flat surface. The labium forms the suckers. The suckers will have those transverse grooves which help in drawing liquid towards the mouth. And the pharynx, by its muscular pumping activity, draws the liquid through this food channel. Then finally, we talked about the siphoning mouthparts of butterflies, which is made by two galleae, which join together to form a straw-like structure. These two galleae would have these median grooves, and they form this straw-like structure. It is kept coiled when it is not in use. And when there is a flower, it can get extended, and this food channel is used to draw the nectar from the flowers. Hope you like this video. Please come for my next video.